Merry Christmas 2022. This is Teddy Claus, and I welcome you to Ted Russ Ministries for Christmas this year. So please, that you're spending some time with God's Word and with me as we celebrate the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ and our Savior. I hope you're having a Christ-filled and joyful holiday. I begin the program with a song I would like to sing for you called Mary, Did You Know? Did you know your baby boy someday walk on water? Mary, did you know your baby boy save our sons and daughters? Did you know your baby boy has come to make us new? The child that you delivered soon deliver you. Mary, did you know your baby boy would give sight to the blind man? Mary, did you know your baby boy would calm the storm with his hand? Did you know your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kissed your little baby, you've kissed the face of God. Mary, did you know? Mary, did you know? The blind will see, the deaf will hear, dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know your baby boy will one day rule the nations? Did you know your baby boy was heaven's perfect lamb? The sleeping child you're holding is the great I Am. Let's continue, friends, with the opening prayer. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. All-powerful and unseen God, the coming of your light into our world has brightened weary hearts with peace. So call us out of darkness and empower us to proclaim the birth of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading for Christmas is taken from Isaiah chapter 9. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressors, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments wrought in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Here ends the reading. Our first song we'll sing together is Hark the Herald Angels Sing. the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all you nations rise, join the triumph of the skies, with angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by, born that we no more may die, born to raise each child of earth, born to give a second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Our second reading is from Luke chapter 2, the Christmas Gospel. In those days a decree went up from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because Joseph was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged, and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for Mary to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in bands of cloth, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to the shepherds, "Do not be afraid, for see, I'm bringing you good news of great joy for all people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in sound bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." This is the gospel of the Lord. Our next song is "Lo, How a Rose is Blooming."
Jesse's lineage coming, as seers of old have sung. It came a flower so bright, amid the cold of winter, when half spent was the night. Isaiah had foretold it, the rose I have in mind. With Mary we behold it, the Virgin Mother kind, to show God's love aright. She bore to us a Savior, when half spent was the night. This flower holds fragrance tender, with sweetness fills the air. Dispels with glorious splendor the darkness everywhere. True man, yet very gone from sin and death, he saves us. Savior, child of Mary, who felt our human woe. Oh, Savior, King of glory, who dost our weakness know. Bring us at length, we pray, the bright courts of heaven, and into endless day.
Abraham Lincoln was assassinated by a well-known actor named John Wilkes Booth on April 14, 1865, something you already know. Killing Lincoln was part of a larger conspiracy intended by Booth to revive the Confederate cause by eliminating the three most important leaders of the United States government. Two conspirators were assigned to kill Secretary of State William Seward. Another man was lined up to kill the Vice President, Andrew Johnson. Except for Lincoln's death, the plot failed. Seward was only wounded, and Johnson's would-be attacker got drunk instead of killing the vice president. After a colorful initial escape, John Wilkes Booth was killed after a 12-day chase. What does this story have to do with Christmas? Here is my answer. The news of President Lincoln's death deeply troubled many people at that time, as you can imagine, and particularly troubled a young minister in Philadelphia named Phillips Brooks. When the slain president's body lay in state in the Independence Hall in Philadelphia, Phillip Brooks went to pay his respects. A few months later, hoping to lift his spirits, the church Brooks served took up a collection and sent him to the Holy Lands. This trip included a horseback ride from Jerusalem to Bethlehem on Christmas Eve. He saw many other famous places where Jesus lived and preached and did his miracles. Phillips Brooks was so deeply inspired by this trip to Israel that 3 years later he wrote a Christmas poem that reflected how much he was touched. Lewis Redner, the church organist, composed a melody to accompany Brooks' poem. The result was a great Christmas carol that begins, "O little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie. Above thy deep and dreamless sleep, the silent stars go by. Yet in thy dark street shineth the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight." My friends, on this Christmas Eve, think about this story. Out of darkness and deep tragedy came a beautiful expression of faith. I hope you remember this story every time you sing, "O Little Town of Bethlehem." Please listen to God's word from 1 John 4, 7-8. "Beloved, let us love one another, For love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God. Christmas is all about love. Almost everyone believes that love's important, but love in our culture is usually thought of as a feeling. But in real life, and according to the Bible, love is a choice and an act of will. As 1 Corinthians 13, 4-8 shows us, Paul writes, love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. Love does not insist on its own way. Love is not irritable or resentful. Love does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends, says God's word in 1 Corinthians. So real love is a choice and action. Jesus was born to teach us how to love. God is the source of our love as Christians. Christmas is all about God, not us. God is the focus of Christmas, not gifts or parties or getting what you want. God is the source of our love that we try to express at Christmas time. God loved us enough to send His Son into our broken world. God loved us enough to sacrifice His Son on the cross for us. God loves us enough to raise Jesus from the dead and open the way for you and me and all believers to receive everlasting life and everlasting hope. This Jesus we worship on Christmas Eve says this in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that everyone who believes in Him may not perish, but have eternal life." Jesus, then, is our example of what it means to love at Christmas or any time. Everything Jesus did in His glorious life, death, ministry, and resurrection was based on love. God also loves us enough to give us what the Bible calls the Holy Spirit. The Spirit gives us the power to love and forgive others today. The Spirit lives in our hearts, and each day it makes us more and more like Christ. God's love always involves a choice and an action, and our love should be like His. Real love, the Bible says, is like God, who is holy, just, and perfect. If we truly know God, we will love as God does. Titus 2:11 to 14 is another one of the Christmas readings. I didn't read it earlier, but I'm going to read part of it now. Here Paul says in Titus, "The grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all, training us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the present age to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. He it is who gave Himself for us, that He might redeem us from our iniquity and purify for Himself a people of His own who are zealous for good deeds." I'm very glad that you're listening tonight to Ted Russ Ministries and helping to observe a Christ-filled Christmas in your home or wherever you may be. I thank God for your life, your faith, and your efforts to live a godly and pure life. I hope and pray it is your desire to receive the gift of God's love this day and also to follow Jesus as His disciple. The Bible says to follow Jesus as a disciple means a number of things. It means receiving God's light and His abundant life. It means receiving God's love over any other treasure. It means receiving eternal life instead of death. It means receiving love instead of judgment, receiving the gift of self-control instead of sinning. It means receiving faith over unbelief and doubt. It means receiving a mission to love now, not later or never. It means receiving a peace from God, the Bible says, surpasses all understanding. After 8-year-old John underwent a long surgery to remove a tumor from his brain, it left a noticeable and ugly scar on the side of his head. When the boy said he felt like a monster, his dad had an idea. His dad decided to demonstrate how much he loved his son by getting a tattoo on the side of his head with the same shape in the same place as his son's scar. When we do things like this, Father, we glorify God and we help God's kingdom grow, sharing God's love, compassion, bringing light to the darkness of others is what Christmas and Christianity is all about. Isaiah 9, 1-2 says, "The people who walked in darkness have now seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined." When the prophet Isaiah lived, he and his people knew all about darkness. They didn't have electricity, some of the comforts we enjoy today. They knew all about darkness, gloom, and despair, and you can see it in the text. Today, when we struggle, we sometimes fear that our darkness and our troubles will never end. But we can take comfort from God's word. Although the Lord may not always spare us from certain troubles, if we follow Him wholeheartedly, He will lead us safely through them. The Apostle John in the Bible also talks about Jesus as the light in John 1 verse 9. And Jesus Himself refers to Himself as the light of the world in John 8 verse 12. On Christmas Eve, when we read this famous text from Isaiah, we ponder how God sent a light for our darkness. We light candles in our churches, in our homes. Isaiah was written during a time of great darkness, but God promised to send a light who would shine on everyone living in the shadow of death. This light that God sent is both Wonderful Counselor and Mighty God. Isaiah's message of hope was fulfilled in the birth of Jesus and the establishment of His kingdom. Jesus came to deliver all people from their slavery to sin. One of the most famous Christmas texts is taken from John 1 verse 14, where it says, "And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen His glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth." Yes, in the mystery of the Word made flesh, God has given us a new revelation of His glory and truth. Above all, God has revealed His grace in the person, in the ministry, in the work of His Son, Jesus. Jesus redeems us from our sins, whatever they may be. This means our sins and failures, our mistakes are forgiven, no matter what they are. This means God loves you and offers you a new future, beginning today. Jesus says in John 10:10, one of my favorite verses in the Bible, Jesus says, "I came that you may have life and have it abundantly." Nicky Banas says, "If you only carry one thing throughout your entire life, let it be hope. Let it be hope that better things are always ahead. Let it be hope that you can get through even the toughest of times. Let it be hope that you are stronger than any challenge that comes your way. Let it be hope that you're exactly where you're meant to be right now, and that you are on the path for where you're meant to be. Because during these times, hope will be the very thing that carries you through." Bruce Stapleton says, "Christmas is most truly Christmas when we celebrate it by giving the light of God's love to those who need it the most." There's a famous American quote that I really like. It goes like this. It's from the Indians, American Indians. "Nothing is as strong as gentleness. Nothing so gentle as real strength." As I look out to you tonight, I think about your life, your joys, your sorrows, your concerns. I see the real strength of God and the real strength of the church. The real strength of the church is you. You trigger the miracles of God. When you obey Christ's word to let your light shine in the darkness of this world, it makes a tremendous difference. Where you work, in your family, where you live, no matter what's going on. Jesus says in John 5:24, I tell you, anyone who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has eternal life and does not come under judgment, but has passed from death to life. So as you gather to celebrate Christmas with a few people or in a large group or maybe just by yourself, there's only one vital message we celebrate during this holiday. There's only one vital message in any generation. That message is Jesus Christ. He loves you. He forgives you. He brings light to your darkness and hope for your future. Jesus wants you to live with him forever in heaven. So what's the good news today? It's very simple. Jesus brings light and life. Amen. My next song is Silent Night. Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child, holy infant so tender. Heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace. Silent night, holy night, shepherds quake at the sight. The Savior is born. Christ the Savior is born. Please join me in our closing prayer. Loving God, we lift up in prayer today all for whom it will be easy to forget this Christmas. Those who are homeless, destitute, we think about the sick, isolated. We think about people in the hospital, those recovering from surgery. We pray for all who have no one to pray for them. Today, we pray especially for some people who have asked for our prayers. Rick Blau, Joe Rust, recovering from surgery, Beverly Carpenter, Ken McCain, Denise Carr, Dolores Bechtel, Marilyn West, Walt Reed, Gary Staley, and Rust. And you may add your own names at this time if you want people to receive those prayers. By your Spirit, Lord, move us to affirm the dignity of all people and to work for just laws that protect the poor and most vulnerable in society. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now, friends, we sing our last song, God Rest Ye Merry Witnesses. God rest ye merry witnesses, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior, born on Christmas Day. to save us soul from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. From God our Heavenly Father a blessed angel came, and unto certain shepherds brought tidings of the same. How that in Bethlehem was born the Son of God by name. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. Tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. Thank you for joining us for Ted Russ Ministries this Christmas time. Hope you can join us next week. God bless you. Enjoy your holiday.